In a way, I think that all Buñuel's work, you know, what are they, 32 films? They're all documentaries, because he's interested in the human condition, isn't he? I mean, that's what these films are about, the human condition, what's going on beneath the surface, particularly what's going on beneath the surface. But you look at Las Hurdes, and he goes to Las Hurdes because he's heard about this place, which is like medieval, where there's illness and poverty. And he goes there, having made An Andalusian Dog and the Golden Age, surrealist films. And he goes and makes what appears to be a documentary, but the drive is the same. The drive is the same. Spanish surrealism, well, it's quite a story. Here in Madrid, where we're sitting, something very strange happened, something unexpected, something that astonished even the person responsible. And the person responsible was called Sigmund Freud. Because in the early 1920s in Spain, Freud's complete works were translated into Spanish. He himself couldn't believe that. He could not believe it. That in Spanish, of all languages, his works, his complete works, were being published before they appeared really in French or English, complete editions. Madrid was astonishing in the 1920s. It wasn't at all cut off from Europe. And it all got underway here very early in Madrid in the early 1920s. And Freud is vital to this process. But not just Freud, the Surrealist Manifesto, written by André Breton, which was published in 1924. Reached Madrid very quickly.
The surrealist movement, it was the surrealism au service de la révolution. Surrealism at the service of the revolution, the communist revolution. This was in Russia, it started at that time, and it was very important that the surrealist movement help this revolution against the bourgeois mentality and values.
So you had Freud working on these young men, on their imaginations. But then also the Surrealist Manifesto, which was much in debt to Freud as well. So all that happened within a few short years. And it happened when there were very brilliant people here waiting to receive the message. And all the young artists and writers and poets were then beginning to produce work in Spain were aware of Freud, and were talking about Freud, and were reading Freud. And among them, Luis Buñuel.
Madrid, Madrid, pedazo de la España en que nací. Por algo te hizo Dios la cuna del requiebro y el chotí. Madrid, Madrid, Madrid.
In Spain during the early part of the centuries, there was a place of encounter for intellectuals, for students, was La Residencia, the residence. Every Saturday night, they used to have, well, Einstein, for example, would come to give a talk, and Freud, and different philosophers and scientists would come to give talks there. And so this was a very important part where a great many of Spain's new intellectuals were meeting.
Because this residence, this hall of residence, whatever it's called in American English, where these young people were living, There were 200 or 150 people there from the two cultures. Some of them were scientists, others were more literary. And they were mixing and discussing. I mean, it was one of the most important places culturally in Europe at the time, really.
And there, my father went to study agricultural engineering. He was very interested in insects. Now, he studied agricultural engineering because his father wanted him to have a decent job. In reality, he was more interested in literature and poetry. But anyway, he studied insects.
And you had people sitting down at lunch and swapping ideas. Somebody who was working on something in botany, for example, talking to somebody who's a poet or a painter, swapping ideas. An amazing library with all these journals coming in from Europe. Reading this stuff completely, totally in contact with what was happening in Paris or London or Berlin. Traveling quite a lot as well. But swapping ideas, recommending books, saying you must see the newest Buster Keaton, which is just, you know, or the newest Chaplin. We must go this evening to, and you know, that sort of environment.
And there he met, luckily, a young poet whose name was Federico Garcia Lorca, and a young painter, Salvador Dali. And they became inseparable. They became three friends, which each one influenced the other, and then there were, of course, many others. They did things also to counter society. For example, they had a girlfriend, who would dress like a prostitute. And she would get on a trolley in downtown Madrid. And a stop later, one of them, either Dalí or Lorca, dressed as a priest, would get on the tramway and start molesting this young prostitute. So there'd be sort of a scandal. And the third stop, my father, dressed as a policeman, would come on and grab the priests and beat him up and tell him what is a priest doing? You're always doing this, bothering prostitutes in the streets. Of course, the whole trolley would be shocked, and then they'd get off and then go have a drink someplace in a bar. And so these are the things they would do apart from their actual work of Dalí painting, Garcia Lorca writing. And my father hadn't met cinema yet, hadn't met the art of cinema yet.
Buñuel a mí me dijo que él realmente se lo debía todo a Federico García Lorca. Él fue quien le inspiró. Una noche Federico le dijo a Luis Buñuel, ven, vamos a salir a ver la luna. Una noche ahí, allí arriba, la luna. Y entonces en ese momento es cuando él sintió la poesía en esa conversación con Federico, y ahí cambió su orientación, porque Buñuel estudiaba ciencia, era un hombre atlético, el deporte, pero eso le llevó esa conversación con Federico, según me dijo a mí Buñuel en su casa el 81, es lo que le inspiró hacia el arte y la creación.
Is a key date in Buñuel's life. What happens? He moves to Paris. He moves to Paris. Like everybody wanted to do in those days, everybody wanted to get to Paris. And this is just the moment when surrealism is the thing. You know, surrealism is not just another art movement which features in the manuals, you know. It's not an art movement. It's a whole way of looking at life. They wanted to change people by digging down into their unconscious minds, by allowing the material hidden away down there to come up to the surface and to be integrated with conscious life, a mixture of the conscious and the unconscious. That is surrealism, beyond realism, something more than realism.
Now, most people have a bad interpretation of surrealism. They think it's above realism or something weird or something strange, and not at all. Surrealism is a form of art. Well, it's more complicated than that, but I'll simplify that it's something that has nothing to do with the rational, automatic thinking. Dreams are a perfect example of surrealism. When you're in a dream, your mind goes completely free. And it invents things, it invents scenes. That is a surrealist act, if you want to call it. What there is, though, in it is a, there's no word for it in English, mala leche, which is Spanish, which sort of, in French, mauvaise foi, it would be a nasty way of thinking that's made to disturb people, to make people question their very values in society.
They really envisaged a new human being, a freer human being, free of the strictures that had acted on him earlier, such as the church, for example, or belief in the nation, indeed in the family. They saw the family as a very restricting element, and they wanted to help people to be freer. So they were flocking to Paris, and Buñuel heard the siren song, he heard the call coming from Paris, come to Paris, come to Paris, Louis. And he went in early 1925. And he immediately got involved in what was happening, totally involved in what was happening in Paris at the time, which was basically this new amazing movement called Surrealism.
So he had a cine club where they'd see films and write critics of the films.
He saw some amazing films in the experimental cinema. The studio Les Ursulines in Paris was putting on the new cinema. And he saw Murnau, he saw Fritz Lang particularly. And he suddenly thought, God, I mean, it's cinema. That's where I'm going to do it. A sort of sudden illumination, a sudden breakthrough.
He was a born filmmaker. In other words, he couldn't write. Every time he wrote, it was a tremendous problem. He couldn't do music because he was deaf, and he was a very bad, he couldn't draw or paint. So his art was cinema.
I mean, what better way to express the workings of the unconscious dream language than through the new alphabet of film, moving images for the first time?
They did plays. He became second assistant and assistant director on films to learn the technique.
And he worked with Jean Epstein on The Fall of the House of Usher. He worked in other films.
And then he took to it naturally, like Orson Welles' first film. Orson was 25 years old when he did his first film, and he'd never done a film before. He had no idea about technique, but he learned it. It was his medium. And I think the same thing with my father. He just came to it naturally. That was his art form. And finally decided after several years, around 27, to do his own film, where his mother paid for it. And that's how he got into the cinema in France.
Both he and Dalí were completely hooked on this idea of being able to express the depths of the unconscious via film.
It took them a week to film it, and they sat down, and the idea was a surrealist idea to give out ideas that had no reference one to the other. In other words, it had to be without any logic.
And that's what they achieved in Un perro andaluz, or as it was originally titled in French, of course, un chien andalou, an Andalusian dog, which is an attempt to express the deepest workings of the psyche in the film.
All the artists of Paris came to the projection, and this was a silent film, so behind the screen, my father had set up a phonograph player, the old wind-up kind, and had a series of records, which he changed manually to give music to the film. And just in case, if there would be a wild reaction or a nasty reaction, he had filled his pockets with stones. So then he would have gone out and stoned the public. But there was a lot of applause, so then he discreetly threw the stones in a potted plant and came out.
That was the film that gave them their entrance into the Surrealist movement, because André Breton and his friends saw the film and said, "It is a Surrealist film. It is the first Surrealist film." And they were very, very impressed by that. And so they decided to let Dalí and Buñuel in, and they became part of the Surrealist group in Paris in 1929.
L'Âge d'Or, The Golden Age, that was the second film that he was going to do with Dalí, but this time they didn't get along. The ideas of each one, nobody approved them. And my father went on to do most, let's say 90% of the script by himself. And once the film was done, there was a presentation in the Studio 28 in Montmartre in Paris, and this caused riots. And there the reaction was at the extreme right. The Camelot du Roi came, and the theater had been decorated with paintings of Miró, of Dalí, of different surrealist painters. And the Camelot du Roi came in and stoned the theater, threw ink on the big screen, ripped all these paintings up. The press was against it, the police was against it, because the chief of police thought that the film deranged society. So he prohibited the film, and L'Âge d'Or was prohibited for 50 years.
El año 32 es un año de grandes convulsiones históricas, ¿no? Sobre todo en España, con la proclamación de la República. Aunque al principio Buñuel acercado un poco a las ideas anarquistas y comunistas, que creían que España estaba en un periodo prerrevolucionario, miró con cierta cautela a la República. No obstante, él abrazó la República y estuvo en un mitin en Zaragoza, los pocos días de proclamarse la República, celebrándolo. Cuando había surgido en el panorama internacional la Revolución Rusa, que se creía, bueno, que fue en un primer momento la revolución extraordinaria del siglo, se dio en España lo que se llama, he llamado yo, la marcha hacia el pueblo de los intelectuales y artistas españoles, por las condiciones, aunque España, como hemos visto, se había modernizado mucho en el siglo XX, en la España rural y en los campesinos, se vivía todavía en un estado semifeudal. Entonces los intelectuales españoles creen que ha llegado el momento, ¿no?, de que el pueblo español, con toda una gran tradición artística, cultural, sea verdadero protagonista, ¿no? Buñuel, con las Hurdes, se acerca a este grupo de artistas, novelistas, pintores. Buñuel, con las Hurdes, deja al lado a los surrealistas. Además, decía, éramos un grupo que estábamos tratando de resolver, cambiar el mundo sentados en las mesas de los cafés de París. Entonces hay que involucrarse a la realidad social, a la acción. Eso es lo que él le llevó a hacer este film de las Hurdes. Entonces él se planteaba hacer un nuevo cine, una nueva película. Su encuentro con un amigo anarquista en Zaragoza, Ramón Asín, parece ser que Buñuel le compró el décimo de lotería y le dijo, mira Ramón, si ganas el premio, me das para hacer la película. Que ganó el premio, le dio, creo que se dice, 20.000 pesetas. Es muy interesante que los surrealistas también, una nueva dimensión de la obra surrealista es su interés en el otro cultural. Entonces él encontró este lugar mismo en España y allí se fue. Con un grupo de amigos, ¿no?, un grupo de amigos vinculados al comunismo, pero también al anarquismo. Hay que tener en cuenta eso, que son los dos grandes, los tres movimientos sociales revolucionarios, comunistas, socialistas y anarquistas. Y Buñuel tenía amigos en los tres grupos y de alguna manera en general se identificaba con principios de los tres.
So the first two films that he did were surrealist films, L'Âge d'Or and Chien d'Alou, and the third film was Terre sans pain, Land Without Bread, which was a documentary on a part of Spain. The poverty was so extreme they didn't have bread there. They would eat grains and whatever they could find in the mountains, but there was no bread. It was that poor. And that film was done to bother the people who saw it, to make them see that the bourgeois values did not help these people. Thou shalt not steal and thou shalt respect the property of others. When you're in extreme misery, those laws mean absolutely nothing.
Por otra parte, Las Hurdes era uno de estos lugares donde se más visible esa opresión y ese mantenimiento de miseria dentro de una España que en el siglo XX había evolucionado hacia la modernidad.
The other thing about Buñuel that I've always liked, there's always been his cynicism, strong sense of irony, but Las Hurdes shows what I've always felt was at the core of it, an anger about the plight of the human condition. Whether it's his contempt for the bourgeoisie, which he can do in a somewhat comic fashion as a discreet charm of the bourgeoisie, his contempt for the bourgeoisie is still no less. It doesn't register itself as angry, but certainly in whatever propelled him to make Las Hurdes, there is a real political anger at the state of injustice that's there.
Thank you.
La memoria y la imaginación de Buñuel es muy libresca, está muy inspirada en obras literarias. Entonces, en Las Hurdes, el libro de Maurice Legendre sobre Las Hurdes, un maravilloso, según Buñuel, estudio de antropología, es el palimpsesto de Las Hurdes, es la base de la película. Buñuel, otra de las cosas que dice frente al cambio de sus dos películas anteriores a esta, es que ahora se enfrenta a la realidad objetiva, tiene una realidad delante, una realidad que Legendre había estudiado en todo detalle en su libro antropológico, y de ahí parte Buñuel, pero claro, él le va a dar una proyección subjetivista y así va a cambiar los documentales etnográficos.
¿Es surrealismo o realismo? Yo, de hecho, cuando empecé a trabajar con Las Hurdes, aquello me pareció totalmente realista.
Pero también dentro de una tradición realista, del realismo ese tradicional español, de toda la vida.
Pero es que luego la película tiene otras cosas como muy propias ya de Buñuel, que estaban avanzadas en Un perro andaluz y en La edad de oro, que son esas formas de tratamiento de la realidad. De tal forma que lo aparentemente objetivo, ¿no?, lo aparentemente así frío, aséptico, realista, sin embargo, hay como algo subterráneo, hay como unas formas de elipsis, de deslizamientos, de tratamientos propiamente cinematográficos, que es lo que le hacen ya que de esa realidad surja la subrealidad. Sí. Los esquemas compositivos que utiliza son totalmente clásicos y además derivan de la pintura más propiamente velazqueña. Es decir, yo, por ejemplo, ahora mismo me acuerdo de la mirada al espectador que tienen muchísimos encuadres, que eso es un procedimiento, tú sabes, perfectamente barroco, muy teatral, por cierto, que es cuando el personaje mira a los espectadores y tiene como una especie de comunicación interna con ellos, ¿no? Eso es lo que utiliza, por ejemplo, Velázquez en Las Meninas o en Las Islanderas. Es decir, personajes que miran directamente al espectador como para haciéndoles partícipe de eso, y es que eso en Las Hurdes, cada dos por tres, de una forma inconsciente, está sucediendo. Lo propio de Buñuel sería un realismo tan suyo, tan propio, tan que ya llega a ser totalmente surrealista.
Sí. Es un realismo que no se queda en la superficie, que no se queda en lo que ve, sino que es un realismo que Buñuel y Galdós llamaban un realismo integral. Bueno, el surrealismo es un realismo integral porque introduce la imaginación, el sueño.
One of the things that is jolting about looking at Las Hurdes after Un Chien Andalou and L'Âge d'Or is that you have this brutal realism. We're watching this woman with a growth on her neck. We're watching a dead child. And on the surface, it would seem to be an abrupt departure. And of course it isn't, because part of what goes on is the juxtaposition of this soundtrack, the utterly neutral tone of the narrator, with the atrocity of the images that we're seeing.
Vous voyez ici le passage d'une rivière avec le cadavre.
And we're forced to make, what do we make of these seemingly incongruous juxtapositions? Here's this man who is so strongly associated with a very recognizable form of surrealism, and he makes a documentary.
And moreover, the earlier films also can be seen as documentaries. They were all fascinated by documentaries, by the possibility of capturing life as it really is. So he goes to Las Hurdes and makes that film. Okay, it's a documentary, but there are sort of scenes that are set up, as we all know, like the goat that falls, well, I mean, and two cameras, you know, documentary, yes, but very subjective elements in the film.
Lo que vemos allí son acontecimientos que pasan en la vida. Pero entonces, en dos siglos de vida que se conocen los Urdanos, Buñuel lo resume en 30, en 29 minutos. Por ejemplo, se comenta mucho eso de que Buñuel se dice, bueno, hay unas pocas cabras y de vez en cuando se desempeñan y se mueren. Y en el cine se ve que es Buñuel el que dispara con un revólver, se ve el humo de revólver, pero Buñuel dice, eso sucede, no me iba a esperar yo aquí un mes o cinco meses hasta que cayera una cabra. Lo mismo el niño muerto que se ve, bueno, es una representación del niño muerto, no muere, pero es que todos los años, todos los días mueren esos niños. Ese niño que tiene unos meses y aparece como la imagen más espantosa o más emotiva de la muerte es un gran actor ya, porque está representando que se ha muerto.
Hay muchísimos aspectos en ese documental que son evidentemente ficticios y que ahí es donde radica precisamente la extremada dificultad en clasificar la película dentro de un género u otro. Si es documental, sería un documental heterodoxo, y si fuera ficción, sería una ficción documental. Con lo cual, incluso desde el punto de vista teórico, introduce una serie de elementos muy interesantes que todavía están debatiéndose en relación con lo que es, el género documental, ¿no? Y el propio cine, en última instancia.
The film was born under two impulses, the documentary impulse and then, say, the Méliès magic impulse. And when you get to surrealism later on, you have, at the point when Buñuel comes along in the late 20s, there are documentaries being made, but there are also experimental documentaries being made. And so you have this whole notion of playing with the form of film. What can film do? Yes, it's a surrealist documentary, but you really have to think that one through. It doesn't sort of announce itself right there at the start, and it is. And you get at more of the core of that. He advanced the cause of film language as much as any other filmmaker. And as with all of his films, he forces us to get into, make sense out of what it is we're seeing. He never, never spells something out. He never makes things easy for his audience. And so Los Herdes, in some ways, is very definitely consistent with the rest of his filmmaking.
En un principio, en la orientación de Buñuel, en relación, estamos hablando siempre de las Urdes, es realizar un documental de tipo antropológico, etnográfico, muy del gusto surrealista del momento, de los años 32, que es cuando gente como Michel Leiris, por ejemplo, dentro del grupo surrealista, se interesan por todo tipo de civilizaciones extrañas, muy difíciles de tener acceso a su modus vivendi, como contraposición a los focos de cultura típicamente europeos, ¿no? Es decir, cómo dentro de la civilización europea avanzada, culta, etcétera, etcétera, podían coexistir zonas donde prácticamente el desarrollo no había llegado, ni la cultura, ni la educación, ni nada. Eso era un planteamiento típicamente surrealista, y dentro de ese contexto, digamos, se mueve Buñuel.
Primero está dirigida, dentro de este documentalismo del cine revolucionario, un ataque contra la propia república, que se decía una república de los trabajadores, pero como había revueltas anarquistas en el campo, la república acababa matándolos o reprimiéndolos. Entonces hay un rechazo de eso y hay que decir, bueno, esta es una república de todos los trabajadores. Miren cómo viven estos trabajadores, ¿no?
decir, que en un principio esa película se iba a llamar Las Hurdes, solamente Las Hurdes. Así consta en el primer comentario que hay, realizado por Pierre Unic y por el mismo Buñuel, con el título Las Hurdes. ¿Qué sucede para que luego todo el mundo conozca esa película como Tierra sin Pan? Lo que pasó es que después de proyectada esa película a poca gente, pero a gente interesante, gente importante, no gustó, y entonces la película cayó en un ostracismo total, se convirtió en una película maldita.
Entonces vieron el propio Marañón, ¿no? Marañón es uno de los grandes intelectuales de los años 20 y 30, que fue un gran defensor de los intelectuales, que propició el clima y impulsó la llegada de la República de alguna manera. Marañón era una persona muy influyente en la República y Buñuel creía que le podría ayudar a que se representara la película prohibida. Marañón le dijo: yo he visto carretas de pan y yendo por Las Hurdes, usted pone las cosas más ofensivas y feas, ¿no? Y Buñuel dice: yo he estado ahí dos meses y medio y no he visto ni un pedazo de pan, ¿no? Entonces se volvió y creo que le dijo, luego pensó: bueno, todo país cree que sus canciones y sus costumbres son las más bellas del mundo, ¿no? Sería absurdo hacer una película de folclore como si esto es lo más bonito del mundo, ¿no?
Y durante 2 años, pues él intenta por todos los medios sacarle un poco de partido. Hay que tener en cuenta que el dinero se lo presta Ramón Acín, y llega un momento que Ramón Acín, pues, dice: oye, ¿qué pasa con mi película? Que quiero sacarle un partido y un rendimiento porque necesito dinero. La película queda totalmente olvidada y entonces, a partir de ese momento, que ya no recibe ninguna ayuda, se convierte en un proyecto totalmente personal.
En cambio, vuelve otra vez, la otra versión es cuando la guerra civil española, y entonces cuando se dice que se politiza un poco y ya no se trata solo de Las Hurdes, sino Tierra sin Pan. Pero hay un homenaje al gran anarquista Kropotkin, decía él que cuando la gente tenga pan se acabarán los grandes problemas políticos y sociales.
Ese cambio de pasar de una postura, digamos, objetiva a una postura totalmente subjetiva por su parte, es lo que hace que él asuma plenamente esa, digamos, nueva autoría de la obra y se convierta en Tierra sin Pan. Se convierta en una película totalmente surrealista, pero también, ya digo, desde un punto de vista político, con una influencia tremenda de las dos facciones propias del surrealismo internacional, por una parte la comunista y por otra parte la anarquista. De todas maneras, ya digo que es un documental, había que hablar más de documental más que de película, que va en contra de todo sistema establecido de poder. Es lo que hace que la película, pues, sea muy poco proclive para que la propia República lo aceptara como vehículo de propaganda en cuanto tal.
Y en ese sentido es curioso que se estrenó en Francia en plena guerra, y ahí pone Buñuel al final un colofón diciendo: bueno, estamos luchando contra el fascismo y tal. O sea, ya se convierte en un arma general, universal, en contra del fascismo y sobre todo el fascismo que se quería imponer en España.
But don't forget, he allowed it to be used. He didn't use it himself as a propaganda tool. It's not agitprop. If it was used for that, he didn't do it himself.
Lo único que sucede, claro, es que eso le ha colgado a la película ya un San Benito que en realidad en su origen no tenía. Y en su origen no era una película de propaganda a favor de la República, sino todo lo contrario, era una película en contra de cualquier tipo de poder que pudiera permitir ese tipo de bolsas de miseria tan grandes como la película refleja.
But the anger that's at the core of Las Hurdes and the not so benign neglect not only of the people in Las Hurdes but other parts of Spain as well, it's a palpable anger.
Buñuel is concerned with poor people and victims everywhere. And that again relates to surrealism, which is about trying to liberate people, to make them fuller human beings. And it's society that counts, not the work of art. You've got to do something to make society better. more authentic. And surrealism for him was a way of getting at that, of doing that, of contributing, by getting at the true human being within. Cutting away, you know, all the shit, all the rubbish, the masks that people wear, and getting behind that to the real person.
Most of his films were done to shock and to make people feel uncomfortable, to make people think a little bit, not to accept what is the pap that is fed to them today.
Well has been subversive in one form or another, no matter what the style of the film or the subject matter. It's all been, in one form or another, subversive. He's made us, he's challenged us in every film he's made. But he never used film as a platform for preaching. Again, we digest what it is that he sees, and we have to do with it what we will. But that's really it. He leaves it up to us, which is more effective than being preached to. I can't think of a film where he ever preached to us.
Puesto que no tenemos que olvidar que los dos primeros, en cierto modo, pues tienen muchísima intervención de Dalí, sobre todo Un perro andaluz, en la Edad de Oro menos, pero quiere decir que por lo menos es cuando Tierra sin Pan inaugura su propio sistema de pensamiento, de escritura cinematográfica y de visión del mundo.
And it's filmed with such beauty and there's such warmth. I mean, Buñuel appeared to be as a tough macho. The muscles, the press-ups, the stomach muscles, you know, all this stuff. So boring. I mean, he appears to be like that, but behind the mask, there's a man of great sensitivity.
Al final de Las Hurdes, los narradores al salir dicen, bueno, después de dos meses salimos de este lugar. Pero Buñuel, en una conversación, añadió, una vez que se ha estado en el infierno, ¿cómo se puede salir del infierno, no? En cambio, Buñuel yo creo que nunca salió de ese infierno por su conmiseración y amor a los urdanos y a la tierra de los urdanos. En ese sentido, le ha acompañado el resto de su vida. Y de hecho, hoy en día, Las Hurdes es una de las películas más universales en la historia del cine y que se vive en todos los días, en todos los confines del mundo.